Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This video is part 4 in the STM32 custom bootloader series. In the previous videos, we saw how the bootloader validates the application before making a jump to it, and how this validation step ensures safe execution. The bootloader checks the magic number, along with the CRC and the size of the application to confirm its integrity. It then compares the calculated CRC with the value that is stored in the application header. If both values match, the bootloader confirms that the application is valid and makes a jump to the application code. In today's video, we will implement the OTA signal mechanism. The basic idea is that the application will download the OTA update, then set an OTA flag and reboot the system. When the system restarts, the bootloader will detect that the OTA flag is set, so it will first clear the flag and then start the update process. Since we do not have the actual OTA implementation yet, we will simulate this signal using an external button. When the button is pressed, the application will set the OTA flag and then reboot the system. I will continue from where we left off in the previous project. Here, I have already loaded both the application and the bootloader projects in STM32 Cube IDE. Let's start by working on the application project first. Here we have the new library files for this project. The files with the app prefix will be used by the application, while the BL files will be used by the bootloader. The flash operation files will remain common for both the application and the bootloader. Copy the app OTA and flash operation source files into the source directory, and copy the corresponding header files into the include directory. Inside the flash operation files, we have functions to read, erase, and write data to the flash memory. These functions are specifically written to modify the flash memory page by page, which matches the flash layout we are using. In the final project, I will also include files for the STM32F446, which uses sector-based flash memory, and those files will contain functions to modify flash sectors instead of pages. The app OTA.c file contains only one function called enableOTARequest. This function first reads the data stored in the application header, and stores it inside a buffer for processing. Then it modifies the first element of the header, which is the OTA flag. It writes a value of 1 at this location, which effectively sets the OTA flag. After that, it erases the entire flash page and writes the modified header data back to the same page. In this way, the actual application header data remains unchanged, and only the OTA flag is updated. Finally, the function resets the MCU so that the bootloader can take control after reboot. The idea is that, in a real scenario, the application will first download the OTA update from the server and then set this flag. Since we are not implementing the OTA download yet, we need another way to signal an OTA request. For this purpose, I am going to use a button. Let's open CubeMX and load the application project. I am going to use the pin PA8 for the button input. Configure this pin as an external interrupt pin. Now go to the GPIO configuration and enable the pull-up resistor for this pin. We will connect the button between this pin and ground. Next, go to the NVIC tab and enable the external interrupt. That is all the configuration we need here, so generate the project now. Let's go back to Cube IDE. When the button is pressed, the pin PA8 will go low. This will generate an interrupt, and the GPIOXD callback function will be called. Inside this callback function, we will call the function that enables the OTA request. We also need to include the appOTA.h header file in the main file. That is all the required code change, so let's build the application project now. Since we have added new functionality, the application size and CRC must have changed. Because of this, we need to recalculate the CRC, so let's open the application project and browse to the debug folder. The application binary file is already generated, so simply run the script to calculate the new CRC. Copy the calculated CRC value and update the application header with this new value. Now build the project again to generate the updated binary file. That completes all the required changes in the application project, so let's close it and move on to the bootloader project. Copy the new library source files into the source directory, and copy the corresponding header files into the include directory. The flash operation file is the same one that we already used in the application project, so there is no change required there. Inside the blotia.c file, we have a function that allows the bootloader to check the OTA request. This function simply reads the data from the application header and stores it inside a buffer for further checking. After that, it looks at the data stored in the first word of the header. If the value is 1, it means the OTA request has been raised by the application, and in this case the function will return 0. If the value is not 1, it means no OTA request is present, and the function will return 1. The next function in this file is used to clear the OTA flag. This function works in a very similar way to how we set the OTA flag in the application. However, instead of setting the flag, it clears the flag by writing a 0 to the same position in the application header. Now let's move on and write the main file for the bootloader. First, include the appotia.h header file. Inside the main function, before the bootloader checks the application validity, it will also check whether an OTA request is present. If the OTA check function returns 0, it means the OTA flag was set by the application, and the bootloader will start the OTA process. Since we do not have an actual OTA image to flash at this point, we will keep things simple. Here, we will just log the information to the console, clear the OTA flag, and then blink the red LED to indicate that an update process is taking place. So the overall flow is like this: the application sets the OTA flag and resets the MCU. After reset, the bootloader detects that the OTA flag is set and performs the required operation. Once the OTA flag is cleared by the bootloader, and we reset the board again, the control will jump directly to the application. Alright, both of our projects are now ready, so let's flash them using the STM32 Cube programmer. Connect the SD link to STM32 Cube programmer and go to the download section. Now browse and select the bin or ELF file. I will flash the ELF file for now, since I do not want to manually enter the start address. The bootloader has been flashed successfully, so now we will move on and flash the application. Alright, both files have been flashed successfully. Now open the serial console to view the log messages. Disconnect the SD link from the Cube programmer and reset the board. You can see that the bootloader has successfully jumped to the application. Now let's assume that the application has successfully downloaded the OTA update, and it is ready to request the update process. At this point, the application will set the OTA flag, which we are simulating using the button. The bootloader detects that the OTA flag has been mentioned as set, and it starts the OTA flashing process. You can see the red LED blinking every 500 milliseconds, indicating that the OTA update is in progress. Once the OTA is flashed, we will later implement an automatic reboot feature in the upcoming videos, but for now, let's manually reset the board. Since the OTA flag was already cleared by the bootloader, the control will now directly jump to the application. So the complete flow is like this: pressing the button sets the OTA flag and resets the board. The bootloader then clears the flag and simulates the OTA flashing process. When we reset the board again, the bootloader directly jumps to the application. Now we have clear control over how the application can trigger the OTA process after downloading the update from the server. In the next video, we will actually flash a new application image. Although it will not be downloaded from the server, we will manually copy it into the bootloader project for demonstration. That brings us to the end of this video. You can download the complete project from the link provided in the video description. Leave a comment if you have any doubts or questions. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.